Good morning. Welcome to Westside. I hope everybody is doing well today. I was greeted by one of our children in the children's ministry by telling me that purple was not my color. And the only reason why I'm wearing purple is because it sparks. So tonight we are starting VBS. So please, it's not too late to register or invite a friend. If you are a guest, you're invited too, and we're so glad you're here. If you would, take the card in the seat in front of you and fill that out and let us know that you visited, because we would love to follow up with you if we had not met you, or find us by me or Pastor Kyle after the service. Or if you're a member, we have a prayer request section, and you can write that prayer request down if you don't feel like telling us or finding us, but we would love to pray for you. This week, before we get the service started, I have two quick announcements, and these are giving you plenty of time to prepare. But on August 7th, we are starting our next discipleship class, Marks of a Disciple, and you can find those there. I would encourage you to attend the class if you are not currently attending our discipleship class. And then my next announcement, which I'm very excited about, is we are going to partner with Connie Maxwell, and other churches are doing it as well, but they're wanting to start something called Passion Initiatives. And so what this is, you know, we all can look at our children and our grandchildren and see that they get tons of opportunity to do a lot of cool things. Like Hayden has been to multiple baseball camps already, he's about to do a soccer camp, but sometimes the children at Connie Maxwell don't get to attend camps. And so some of the kids, the way it was explained to me is, they just don't really know what they're good at. And they want opportunities to teach these children different skills and passions that they have. And so we're going to have an interest meeting on August the 7th. And we're going to have a representative from Connie Maxwell come over. And what they're trying to do is every Sunday night, starting in, I think, probably late August, and it's going to run the school year and then take off in the summer. But for 1 hour on Sunday nights, I believe if I remember correctly, you'll find out in the meeting, I think it's 4 to 5. Is the time you can help teach kids skills. And so they had a long list of like 50 things, but some of the main ones that they highlighted, a girls only dance class, like an exercise class, or golf, or pickleball even. We got a lot of pickleball players. And so what they're asking is for churches to like partner up two people or even a group of four and rotate every Sunday if you can't commit 4 Sundays a month, and just hang out and play with the kids and teach them an activity they enjoy and want to learn. And so there's minimal prep on our end, but if you're interested in volunteering and serving our community in that way, please come to this interest meeting. They will explain it much better than I just did. And so those are my announcements today. Let us start in musical worship.
Thank you, Chris, and congratulations on being fourth on the hot dog eating contest yesterday.
promise I'll do better next year.
He'll be prepared next year, yeah. I think he looks pretty good for having eaten 30 hot dogs yesterday, so that's good. We're at our series on Psalms. If you can, would you stand with us? Psalm 32 is what we're going to be focusing on today, and it talks about the greatest blessing that we have as believers. Blessed is the man who is, what would you think? Blessed is the man who is healthy. Well, that's a blessing. Blessed is the man who is wealthy. That's a blessing. Blessed is the man who is powerful. That is a blessing, but it's not that. The greatest blessing, blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven. If your sins are not forgiven, you have nothing else to look forward to. Trust me. So this morning we're going to be singing together. Everybody needs forgiveness. Sing along with us.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. As you find me, all my fears and failures, fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender.
Now I surrender.
Savior, mighty to save, He is mighty to save forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
You may be seated.
Well, we have come to the time in our service where we pray for a particular missionary or a church plant or something with our association or an activity we have here at church. And obviously, VBS is starting tonight. What better thing for us to pray about as you go through your week? If you're not volunteering and serving at VBS, you can still partake in VBS by praying for us. And so this week, pray for our volunteers so they will have energy, that we will be unified as a church as we give the gospel to these children, that their hearts will be receptive to the gospel, and then also for the visitors that have signed up and will be attending this week. So let us pray and ask the Lord to bless VBS. Father, we are thankful for our opportunity to come and worship you. You are good, you are sovereign, you are wise, and we praise you for that. And you've seen it fit for us to host VBS and have children come and attend. And Lord, I pray that we do not waste our opportunity, but we will clearly give them the gospel, and that they will have fun, and that they will have good fellowship with friends, but Lord, that most importantly, they will come to know you as Lord and Savior. And so, Father, I pray that you will bless our efforts. In your name we pray. Amen.
Our son has been in law enforcement all of his career, and once in a while when he would be in a restaurant in uniform years ago, he would go up and to pay for his meal, and someone there would say at the counter, "It's okay, somebody's already paid your bill." It was always an unexpected blessing and always a reinforcement to him, an encouragement to him. How much better is it that when we go before heaven and the debt of our sin, which is immeasurable, is on our ticket, and we go before the Father and he says, "No problem, somebody's already paid for it. My son, Jesus Christ." If you can, would you stand with us as we sing together, "Jesus Paid It All"?
I hear the Savior say, "Thy strength indeed is small. Shout of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Throne, I stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised it.
Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Second grade and under are dismissed at this time for your worship. The rest of you may be seated. You're getting used to sitting down, aren't you? That's good. This morning, we're going to finish out our music set with a song called O Come to the Altar. And it is a song that talks about the appeal for salvation, the appeal for you to come and place yourself as a living sacrifice on the altar to God, asking for his justification, forgiveness of your sins, asking for his sanctification, a process to become like Jesus, and asking for glorification, that one day promise of being with him in heaven. So sing with us, O Come to the Altar.
Father's arms are open wide for forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you've found.
All right, here's a test on your memory. 2013, do you remember the name Edward Snowden? Some of you were little kids in 2013, so you may not, but Edward Snowden was the 29-year-old who was behind the biggest leak in the history of the National Security Agency, and he caused an uproar in 2013 by releasing information that told us the scope of how much government surveillance was going on among private citizens. And up until that time, it was kind of just a lot of conspiracy theories about the kind of surveillance that we were under. That was before he proved that the NSA was keeping records about like every phone call we made and everything we used our cell phones for. And they were looking at a level that no one could imagine. And I suspect now that I'm even talking about it, and this is going to be put on the internet, I will probably be added to a list by even bringing up the name Edward Snowden in this sermon. But this leak that he had it started a national conversation about privacy, or we'll say the lack of privacy that we have. And really the only way you and I can stay off a radar is to go off the grid. And by off the grid, I mean we need to not use the internet, only pay with cash, get rid of cell phones. That's number one on the list. I mean, there are a lot of things that we would have to do. But even then, there is like satellite surveillance. There's face recognition stuff. You know, there's a company that provides information technology stuff for churches, software. And they said, hey, we can set up cameras in your lobby, and it has face recognition where everybody that comes to church, it has their face recognition. It takes attendance and keeps track of everyone that comes. Like, no, thank you. That's we don't need that. That sounds a little creepy. But there are some churches that sign up for that. There's that kind of technology. There's surveillance. And there's no way to dodge it. But despite the best efforts of the NSA, which seems pretty broad, those efforts pale in comparison to God's complete knowledge. NSA's only been around for a few decades. Their technology's only been around for a few decades. But over 3,000 years ago, the psalmist wrote in Psalm 139, God, you know where I sit. You know when I sit. You know when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. And God's complete knowledge is a problem for you and I, and it's a problem for you and I because all of us sin. And that means that God in his complete knowledge knows our sin. He knows the good and he also knows the bad as well. And this is why forgiveness, which is what we're going to talk about this morning from Psalm 32, is the greatest blessing that you and I could ever imagine. Because the God who knows all of our sin, who has complete knowledge of all of our sin, even those that we think are hidden sins that nobody else knows about, is the same God who will forgive all of our sin. And that's a greater blessing than we can imagine. That's a greater blessing than having your house paid off. That's a greater blessing than having student debt erased. That's a greater blessing than having that speeding ticket taken off your record. Forgiveness is the greatest blessing that you and I could ever imagine. Because when God forgives you, he wipes the slate clean, all of it. And King David, he tried to hide some of his sins. He tried to cover up some of his sins. Remember the life of David. You're well aware of the fact that when all the soldiers went off to war, David stayed behind in Jerusalem and seduced the officer's wife, and she became pregnant. David arranged to have the husband killed, and so now we have sins of adultery and murder on his hands, and he tried as hard as he could to cover up, to hide those sins. But God used the prophet Nathan to confront David in his sin. And in Psalm 51, David described his confession to God after Nathan the prophet confronted him. And as part of that confession in Psalm 51, David promised that he would teach transgressors God's ways so that they would find forgiveness and return to him. So after David's experience, he said, you know what? I'm going to teach other sinners about what you need to do to find forgiveness. And so many commentators think that Psalm 32 is David living up to that promise. When he said, I'm going to teach God's forgiveness. I'm going to teach the ways of God, how he's able to forgive, what you need to do to find forgiveness from God. I'm going to teach that. And some think that Psalm 32 is him teaching that about forgiveness. This is the fulfillment to that promise. And so as we read the first five verses of Psalm 32, there's a question I want to ask you. Do you try and cover up your sin, or do you allow God to cover up your sin? Because we'll see today that there's a right way to cover up sin, and there is a wrong way to cover up sin. And let's be honest, we're a whole lot like our mommy and daddy. And by mom and dad, I mean Adam and Eve. We are a whole lot like Adam and Eve in the fact that when we fall into sin, we immediately try to cover it up. We immediately try to hide it ourselves. And the truth is that is an absolute losing proposition when it comes to God. He has complete knowledge of our sin. We can't hide anything from God. And so let's look at Psalm 32. If you want to find that in your Bible, it'll be on the screen as well. But we're going to look at the first five verses. But first, I want us to look at the first two verses because we're going to see the blessing we receive when we allow God to cover up our sin. Remember, there's a good way and a bad way. Either God covers up your sin or you try and cover up your sin. And the first two verses describe the blessing we receive when we allow God to cover up our sin. So let's read those first two verses together. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. This psalm begins with blessed. which is a word for joy, a word for happiness, a joy for a word for celebration. And so how in the world is David, who just committed some egregious sins, I mean, we got some big ones here, adultery and murder, how is he twice in these first two verses declaring blessed is the man? Because David stood on the promise that you and I have as well. That our sin can be covered. Our sin cannot be held against us. He banked on the promise that when he confessed his sin to God, that he would receive forgiveness. And he says it multiple times here. What David's doing is what I get accused of sometimes. I repeat things for emphasis. Do y'all do that? I'll say the same thing three different ways, and people, I get it. I know what you're saying. Yes, I got it the first time. But I, you know, sometimes there's that question, did they get it? So I'll say it another way. That's what David did here. He said the same thing three different ways in these first two verses. He's saying, blessed, he says first, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven. And so in that phrase, the word transgressions there is, of course, describing sin, and it's a word that literally means rebellion, that means kind of disloyalty. That's how he's describing sin in that phrase. And God created us in his image as his representatives here on earth, and in rebellion, we revolted against his will and his rule for our life, and in doing so, we sinned. Those are those transgressions. We have sinned against God and our disloyalty to how we are to live. And so he said, blessed is those whose transgressions, that's the description for sin there, whose transgressions are forgiven is the word he uses. And forgiven literally means, the word here, carried away or lifted off. It gives us the idea that our sin, our transgressions were like a boulder that was pinning us to the ground, and God lifted it off of us and carried it away. That's what he's done with our sin. That burden that was on us, that has been lifted up. That has been carried away. And again, he repeats the same idea from transgressions are forgiven. Now he says, for whose sins are covered. Very similar phrase, but different words that he used. That second word he used to describe sin there, which in the ESV's translated as sin, literally means to miss the mark. It's the idea of an archer who draws a bow and shoots the arrow at a target, and the arrow just kind of falls short and sticks into the ground. It's missing the mark. It's when a golfer lines up to hit a drive right down the middle of the fairway, and yet he kind of slices it off into the woods to the right. He's missed the mark. He's missed the fairway that he was aiming for. And that's the idea of what this sin is, that we have missed the mark, that God had this plan, God had this will, this law to guide us, and we missed the mark. That's the description of sin here. And in this phrase, whose sins are, here's the word for forgiveness, whose sins are covered. I love this description because this has to do with atonement. This points straight to Jesus. Just as the blood of a sacrifice covered the sins of the people and restored that relationship with God on the Day of Atonement in the Old Testament under that sacrificial system, it's the same way with Christ on the cross. That when we place our faith in Christ, when we confess our sin to him, God covers over our sin, not with the blood of animals on a doorpost, but with the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ, covers our sin. And it's out of sight. It will never be brought up again as a form of judgment. And so now David, if two times wasn't enough, he's going to say the same thing over a different way a third time, really to drive home the point. And here, in verse 2, blessed is the one whose sin, the ESV translates this word as sin. It's literally the word for iniquity, which means a crooked or wrong act. And it has the nuance of whatever's right, perverting, twisting that to what is wrong. That's the word for iniquity there. And in this description, the forgiveness he describes as blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against him. This sin is not charged to our account. When we confess Christ, when we receive forgiveness, that debt is not charged to our account. This is a bookkeeping phrase. This is an accounting word for those of you that are CPAs or deal with numbers. When God forgives us, he doesn't charge the sin to our account. It's the same accounting word that Moses used in Genesis chapter 15 to describe the righteousness Abraham had by faith when it says this, Abraham believed the Lord and it was counted to him as righteousness. And I love it because in God's accounting, which wouldn't work with money if you're a CPA. A few people have tried it and their picture has been on the front page of the newspaper. But in God's accounting, God leaves sin off the ledger. And not only does he leave sin off the ledger, it's not counted against us, but he adds his righteousness to the ledger. How unbelievable is that? He doesn't just not put down the sin in the ledger book, but he adds his righteousness to our ledger. It's as if we racked up way more charges than we could afford to pay on a credit card, and then you nervously wait for that bill to come in the mail, and you open that Capital One bill, and you see that there's a zero. The debt has been paid. The balance is zero. The minimum payment, zero. The penalties, zero. That's what our sin has been removed from God's ledger book. And the spreadsheet is now empty. We owed an unpayable debt. We owed a debt that we could not afford to pay off. But Christ paid that debt for us on the cross. This is what he's saying. This accounting phrase, when the sin is not held against us, it does not count against us. This is a strong description of the forgiveness that you and I have received if we've placed our faith in Jesus Christ. What a blessing. What a blessing when we confess our sin that it is covered up. It is forgiven. But I want to draw our attention now to the next two verses, because this is what happens when we try and cover up our own sin. This is what happens when we try and hide our sin. Listen to what David said in verses 3 and 4. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as it is in the heat of summer. There's a simple spiritual law that's so basic that confess sin, God will cover it up. You will be blessed. Conceal sin, try to cover it up yourself, and we can expect discipline. In David's life and in ours, the pain, the sorrow, the headache, the heartache of sin's cover-up can take different forms of punishment, of discipline from God. For David, the sin of his life, it brought physical suffering. Maybe you've been there. David kept silent concerning his sin with Bathsheba, and it wasn't until he was confronted by Nathan did he acknowledge that sin. But it appears that before that confrontation, before Nathan confronted him and his sin with Bathsheba, that his cover-up was eating away at him. Sin can have that effect. As we hold on to that sin, as we try and cover it up and hide it and not confess it and give it to God, it has a way of eating away at us. He said his bones wasted away. He said that he groaned all day and night. Physically, he was drained from his sin. And there was emotional suffering as well. I mean, he was at an end of himself. I mean, you imagine, I mean, he describes it as groaning. It's the same word that's like a lion or thunder or a warrior, a person in extreme pain, that loud just groan. That was what he was dealing with. It was eating away at him. And we know that sin can consume, sin can destroy. And that's what was happening in the life of David as he tried to conceal that sin. But there can also be spiritual suffering as well. Verse 4, David described the suffering as intense, as heavy, day and night. And notice what was so heavy. Heavy because it was God's own hand that was bringing that pressure on him, which we think, well, that sounds judgmental. That's a loving hand. That is God looking at a child who is dealing with sin, knowing in his sovereignty the effect that sin is going to have on his child's life. And that is him trying to get their attention. That is him saying, look, this sin can eat away at you. And God will discipline us to get our attention because he knows the effect that sin can have on our lives. This is the loving hand of a parent that disciplines a child to guide them in the right path. This is God's heavy hand trying to get David's attention. Is it painful at times? Yes. But God knows the long-term effects of sin on our life, and sometimes he'll bring about some emotional struggle, some physical struggle, even that kind of that feeling that David's describing here of being sapped like in the heat of summer. That's a pretty good description for us. The barbecue festival, we missed it this year. The barbecue festival, I'm convinced, is always the hottest weekend of every year when they had the festival Discovery, but it was only in the 80s this year, not 180. And so, but you know how sapped you are in the heat of summer when you're outside working. I mean, it just drains you. Of course, he's writing to an audience that was familiar with the desert, and so they know what it's like to be just zapped under the heat of the sun. It can wipe away your energy, and that's a mild description of what sin can do for you and I. This is a far cry from blessed is the man. Blessed is the man, verse 1 and 2. To now we see a man that is just absolutely sapped of strength. Physically drained, emotionally drained, spiritually drained. But that is the price for covering up sin. David was feeling that conviction, that heavy hand from God. A loving hand from God trying to get his attention. And there are a lot of reasons that you and I might try to cover up our sin, conceal our sin, hide our sin. I think the number one reason is pride. We don't like to admit that we're wrong. Other times we might not confess sin out of a sense of despair. We can feel so overcome by guilt at times that over what we've done that we don't think God can actually forgive us, so we're scared to even bring it up like God doesn't already know. But these avenues of God getting our attention, getting David's attention, the goal of all of it is to bring us back to him. That's what he's doing. He knows the effects of our sin. the seminary president of where I went, he had this phrase that he would always use. He would describe God as the hound of heaven. But he's that faithful father that doesn't give up. He keeps trying, and he is, that's that heavy hand of discipline to try and get our attention. So David's pain, David's anguish here, the emotional struggle that he's going through, it's not accidental, it's providential. It is God loves him too much to allow him to continue on the path that he is on. God's at work pulling David back to himself. And the beautiful thing is that David responds. Let's end with reading verse 5 together. After what he went through of trying to conceal and hide his sin and the burden that that was, he says, "Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin." That weight that David was carrying of his sin and that discipline he was receiving from God, it brought him to this point of repentance, this point of confession of sin to God. And that's what we see in verse 5. Complete forgiveness, and it's kind of a two-step process. And I think it's one that we can follow as well. We see that David first said, "I acknowledged my sin." We have to acknowledge our sin. Ultimately, see who he acknowledged that sin to. "I acknowledge my sin to you." Sometimes we think about how we sin to the people around us, and we can wrong people, but all sin ultimately I got a Pentecostal daughter. We're gonna start running. I need to teach her to say hallelujah when she runs across the front of the For those of you that ask, how's your daughter doing with her new medication? Pretty good. She's fast. Might need a new medication for me now. David acknowledged his sin. That's the first step. Before we confess it, we have to acknowledge it. David is now seeing his sin in the same way that God sees sin. He's not trying to hide anything. He acknowledges that what he had done, yeah, it wronged people, but ultimately it was sin against God. So he acknowledges it, and then we see, look at the second phrase there. "I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord." He acknowledged his sin, and now we see him confessing his sin. Just like that prodigal son, which is one of my favorite stories from Scripture, David came to his senses. He had a hard, honest discussion with himself. As he acknowledges the sin in his life, he realizes it, and he tells himself, I need to confess this. Just like that prodigal son, as he's in that pit of waste that pigs wouldn't even eat the food he was feeding himself, he has this honest conversation with, this is where I am. This is where my life is. And he acknowledged that and confessed that and went to the Father and found forgiveness. Psalm 28:13 says, "He who covers his sin will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will receive mercy." 1 John 1:9 says, "If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness." This is the promise that is ours. And this psalm, Psalm 32, was Augustine's favorite psalm. It's said that he inscribed this psalm on the wall next to his bed as he was in his last days of life. And he said that he loved this psalm so much because he said this: the beginning of knowledge is to know oneself to be a sinner, to acknowledge where we are, what we've done, what that's done to our relationship with God, and to be able to confess that to Him. And that's the beginning. But it doesn't have to be the end, because in Christ, you can be a forgiven sinner. Your sin can be forgiven. Your sin can be covered. The good news is that because of what Jesus Christ has done for us, when we acknowledge our sin and we confess it to Him and we respond to Him in faith and surrender our lives to Him, our sin is covered up. Our sin is not counted against us. And not only that, but His righteousness is gifted to us. Martin Luther said, sin has two places where it may be. Either it may be with you, so that it lies upon your neck like that burden, or upon Christ, the Lamb of God. If it lies on your neck this morning, it means that you're lost. You haven't accepted Christ, that you haven't received that forgiveness of sin that comes by following Him. But if you are a believer in Christ, your sin has been placed on the Lamb of God. You don't carry that burden anymore. Acknowledge your sin. Confess that sin to Him. Don't try and hide it. Don't carry that burden of concealing that sin. It is fruitless. But acknowledge, confess sin. Allow God to cover it up through the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Forgiveness is the greatest blessing that you and I have as believers in Christ. And so I hope that that's a reminder this morning of the blessing that we have through Jesus Christ. And if there's someone here who doesn't know Christ, who hasn't received that forgiveness of sin, don't leave here without taking care of that. Don't leave here without surrendering your life to Jesus Christ, confessing, acknowledging your sin to Him. Let's pray together as we close. Father, we are a sinful group here at Westside this morning. Through the conviction of your Holy Spirit, may we acknowledge that. May we confess that, because where there is confession, there is forgiveness. And it is complete forgiveness. It's not partial. So, Father, we celebrate that this morning as believers in Christ, that His blood on the cross was sufficient to cover our sin. We rest in that this morning. We take comfort in that promise that our sins are forgiven, that eternity in your presence is ours. Father, if there is anyone here who has not acknowledged their sin, confess that sin to you, then we pray your Holy Spirit work in their hearts and lives even right now. We pray these things in the name of Christ, our Savior. Amen. As we close this service, use this time. Thank God for His forgiveness. Confess any sin that you may need to as we stand together and sing this final song.
Just as I am.
thank you for being here this morning. Sorry about the construction zone as you walked in, as we are getting new flooring, but they are almost done, and we'll have it ready to go by next Sunday. But round two. All right. Again, thank you for being here this morning. Coach, will you say a word of prayer for us as we close this service?
Grandma.